Presbyterian occupation, as the watering of flowers is rather Milton's duty than yours, especially at a moment when intellectual pleasures await you. Your German grammar is on the table. Pray open it at page 15. We'll repeat yesterday's lesson.
But I don't like German. It isn't at all a becoming language. I know perfectly well that I look quite plain after my German lesson.
Child, you know how anxious your guardian is that you should improve yourself in every way. He laid particular stress on your German as he was leaving for town yesterday. Indeed, he always lays stress on your German when he is leaving for town.
Dear Uncle Jack is so very serious. Sometimes he is so serious that I think he cannot be quite well.
Your guardian enjoys the best of health, and his gravity of demeanor is especially to be commended in one so comparatively young as he is. I know no one with a higher sense of duty and responsibility.
I suppose that is why he often looks a little bored when we three are together.
Cecily, I'm surprised at you. Mr. Welling has many troubles in his life. Idle merriment and triviality would be out of place in his conversation. You must remember his constant anxiety about that unfortunate young man, his brother.
I wish Uncle Jack would allow that
unfortunate young man, his brother,
to come down here sometime. We might have a good influence over him. I'm sure you certainly would. You know German and geology and things of that kind influence a man very much.
I am not sure that even I could produce any effect in a character that, according to his own brother's admission, is irretrievably weak and vacillating. Indeed, I'm not sure that I would desire to reclaim him. I'm not in favor of this modern mania for turning bad people into good people at a moment's notice. As a man sows, so let him reap. You must put away your diary, Cecily. I really don't see why you should keep a diary at all.
I'll keep a diary in order to enter the wonderful secrets of my life. If I didn't write them down, I should probably forget all about them.
Memory, my dear Cecily, is the diary that we all carry about with us.
Yes, but it usually chronicles things that have never happened and couldn't possibly have happened. I believe memory is responsible for nearly all the three-volume novels that Moody sends us.
Do not speak slightingly of the three-volume novels, Cecily. I wrote for myself in earlier days.
Did you really, Miss Prism? How wonderfully clever you are! I hope it did not end happy. I don't like novels that end happily. They depress me so much.
The good ended happily, the bad unhappily. That is what fiction means.
I suppose so, but it seems very unfair. Was your novel ever published?
Alas, no. The manuscript, unfortunately, was abandoned. I use the word in the sense of lost or mislaid. To your work, child, these speculations are profitless.
But I see dear Dr. Tossel coming up
to the garden. Dr. Tossel, this is indeed a pleasure.
And how are we this morning? Miss Prism, you are, I trust, well.
Miss Prism has just been complaining of a slight headache. I think it would do her so much good to have a short stroll in the park with you, Dr. Tossel.
Cecily, I have not mentioned anything about her headache.
No, dear Miss Prism, I know that, but I felt instinctively that you had a headache. Indeed, I was thinking about that and not my German lesson when the rector came in.
I hope, Cecily, you're not inattentive.
Oh, I'm afraid I am.
That's strange. Were I fortunate enough to be Miss Prism's pupil, I would hang upon her lips. I spoke metaphorically. My metaphor was drawn from bees. Mr. Worthing, I suppose, has not returned from camp yet.
We do not expect him till Monday afternoon.
Ah, yes, he usually likes to spend his Sundays in London. He's not one of those whose sole aim is enjoyment, as well accounts for an unfortunate young man his brother seems to be. But I must not disturb Egeria and her pupil any longer.
Egeria? My name is Letitia, Doctor.
A classic old illusion, merely drawn from pagan authors. Come on, that's even worth it.
I think you're not. I will want to talk with you. I find I have a headache after all, and walk might do it good.
With pleasure, Miss Prism, with pleasure. We might go as far as the schools and back.
That would be delightful. Cecily, you will read your political economy in my absence. The chapter on the fall of the rupee you may omit. It is somewhat too sensational. Even these metallic problems have their melodramatic side.
Ugh, horrid political economy, horrid geography, horrid, horrid, yeah.
Mr. Ellsworth,
met him when Miss Prism were in the garden. He said he was anxious to speak to you privately for a moment. Ask Mr. Earnestworth to come here. I suppose you'd better talk to the housekeeper about your room for me. Yes, miss. I have never met any really wicked person before. I'd be rather frightened. I'm so afraid he will look just like everyone else. He does!
You are my little cousin Cecily, I'm sure.
You are under some strange mistake. I am not little. In fact, I believe I am more than usually tall for my age. But I am your cousin Cecily. You, I see from your card, are Uncle Jack's brother. My cousin Ernest. My wicked cousin Ernest.
Oh, I'm not really wicked at all, cousin Cecily. You mustn't think that I'm wicked.
If you are not, then you have certainly been deceiving us all in a very inexcusable manner. I hope you've not been leading a double life. Pretending to be wicked and being really good all the time. That would be hypocrisy.
Well, I have been rather reckless.
I'm glad to hear it.
In fact, now that you mention the subject, I have been very bad. In my own small way.
I don't think you should be so proud of that, though. I'm sure it must have been very pleasant.
It is much pleasanter being here with you.
I can't understand how you are here at all. Uncle Jack will be back till Monday afternoon.
That is a great disappointment. For I am obliged to be about the first train on Monday morning. I have a business appointment I am anxious to miss.
Well, I know, of course, how important it is not to keep a business engagement if one wants to retain any sense of the beauty of life. But still, I think you had better wait till Uncle Jack arrives. I know he wanted to speak to you about your emigrating.
But my what?
Your emigrating. He has gone off to buy your outfit.
I certainly wouldn't let Jack buy my outfit. He has no taste in neckties at all.
I don't think you will require neckties. Uncle Jack has sent you to Australia.
Australia? I'm going to die!
Well, he said at dinner on Wednesday night that you would have to choose between this world, the next world, and Australia.
Well, the accounts I've received of Australia and the next world are particularly encouraging. This world is good enough for me, Cousin Cecily.
Yes, but are you good enough for it?
I'm afraid I'm not that. That is why I want you to reform me. You may make it your mission, if you don't mind, Cousin Cecily.
I'm afraid I've no time this afternoon.
Well, would you mind my reforming myself this afternoon?
It is rather quixotic.
Well, I feel better already.
You are looking a little worse.
That's because I'm hungry.
How thoughtless of me! I should have remembered that when one is going to lead an entirely new life, one requires regular and wholesome meals. Won't you come in?
Thank you. Might I have a buttonhole first? I don't have any appetite at all until I have a buttonhole first.
Marshall, yeah.
No, I'd sooner have a pink rose.
Why?
Because you are like a pink rose, Cousin Cecily.
I don't think it can be right for you to talk to me like that. Miss Prism never says such things to me.
Well, Miss Prism is a short-sighted old lady. You are the prettiest girl I ever saw.
Miss Prism says that all good looks are a snare.
They are a snare that any sensible man would like to be caught.
Oh, I don't think I would care to catch a sensible man. I should know what to talk to him about.
You are too much alone here, Dr. Chasuble. You should get married. A misanthrope I can understand. A womanthrope never.
Leave me. I do not deserve so neologistic a phrase. The precept as well as the practice of the primitive church was distinctly against matrimony.
That is obviously the reason why the primitive church has not lasted up to the present day. And you do not seem to realize, dear doctor, that by persistently remaining single, a man converts himself into a permanent public temptation. And to be more careful, these scary celibacy leads weaker vessels astray.
But is a man not equally attractive when married?
No married man is ever attractive except to his wife.
And often I've been told not even to her.
That depends on the intellectual sympathies of the woman. Maturity can always be depended on. Ripeness can be trusted. Young women are green. I spoke horticulturally. My metaphor was drawn from fruits.
Chaucer. I hope you are well.
Dear Mr. Worthing, I trust this garb of woe does not token some terrible calamity.
My brother.
The more shameful debts in extravagance.
Still leading his life of pleasure.
Dead!
What? Brother Ernest? Dead.
Oh yes, quite dead.
What a lesson for him. I trust he will profit by it.
Mr. Worthing, I offer you my sincere condolence. You have at least the consolation of knowing that you are the most generous and forgiving of brothers.
My poor brother Ernest! To be carried off? Suddenly, it is a sad, sad blow.
Very sad indeed. Were you with him at the end?
Oh, no. He died abroad, in Paris, in fact. I received a telegram from the manager of the Grand Hotel.
Is the cause of death mentioned?
Yes. It seems it was. A severe chill.
As a man says, so shall you leave.
Oh, charity, dear Miss Prism, charity. None of us are perfect. I myself am peculiarly susceptible to drafts. You would, no doubt, wish me to make some slight allusion to this tragic domestic affliction next Sunday. My sermon on the meaning of the manna in the wilderness can be adapted to almost any occasion, joyful, or as in the present case, distressing. I've preached it at harvest celebrations, christenings, confirmations, on days of humiliation and festival days. The last time I delivered it was in the cathedral, as a charity sermon on behalf of the Society for the Prevention of Discontent amongst the upper orders. The bishop, who was present, was very much struck by some of the analogies I drew.
Ah, yes, I believe you mentioned christenings, dear doctor. I suppose you know how to christen all right. I mean, you are continually christening, aren't you?
It is, I regret to say, one of the rector's most constant duties in this parish. I've often spoken to the poorer classes on the subject, but they do not seem to know what thrift is.
But is there any particular infant whom you are interested in, Mr. Werther? Your brother was, I believe, unmarried, was he not?
Oh, yes.
And people who live entirely for pleasure usually are.
But it is not for any infant, dear doctor. No, I'm very fond of children. The fact is that I will lie to the prison myself. This afternoon, if you've nothing better to do.
But surely, Mr. Worthing, you've been christened already.
I don't remember anything about it.
Have you any great doubts on the subject?
Oh, I certainly intend to. But I don't know if it would bother you at all or not, or if you think I'm a bit too old for it now.
Not at all. The sprinkling, indeed, the immersion of adults is a perfectly canonical practice.
Immersion?
Oh, you have no apprehensions. The sprinkling is often necessary, or indeed, I think advisable. Our weather's so changeable. What hour would you wish the ceremony performed?
Oh, I might trot out in about 5 if that suits you.
Perfectly. In fact, I have 2 similar ceremonies to perform at that time. A case of twins that occurred recently in one of the outlying cottages of your estate. Poor Jenkins the carter, the most hard-working man.
Oh, no, I don't think that would be very much fun being christened with other babies. It's a bit childish. Would 5:30 work for you?
Admirably. Admirably. And now, dear Mr. Worthing, I will no longer intrude into a house of sorrow. I would merely beg that you would not bow down too much by grief. What seem to us bitter trials are often blessings in disguise.
This seems to me a blessing of an extremely obvious kind.
Uncle Jack! Oh, I'm pleased to see you back. But what horrid clothes you've got on. Did go and change them?
Seriously.
My child, my child.
What happened to your mother? Do you look happy? You look as if you had a toothache, and I've got such a surprise for you. Who do you think is in the dining room? Your brother! Your brother Ernest! He arrived about 1/2 hour ago.
That's nonsense. I haven't got a brother.
Uncle Jack, don't be like that. However badly he may behave to you in the past, he is still your brother. You wouldn't be so heartless as to disown him. I'll tell him to come out, and you will shake hands with him, won't you, Uncle Jack?
Joyful
tidings. My son return seems to me peculiarly distressing.
My brother is in the dining room. I don't know what it all means. I think it is perfectly absurd.
Brother John, I have come down from town to tell you that I am very sorry for the trouble I have given you. That
I intend to lead a better life in the future.
Uncle Jack, you are not going to refuse your own brother's hand.
Nothing will induce me to take it. I think his coming here disgraceful. He knows perfectly well why.
Uncle Jack, do be nice. There is some good in everyone. Ernest has just been telling me about his poor invalid friend, Mr. Butler.
About Bunbury, has he?
Yes, he told me all about poor Mr. Bunbury and his terrible state of health.
Bunbury. Well, I won't have him talking to you about Bunbury or anything else. It's enough to drive him perfectly frantic. Of course, I admit the thoughts were all on my side. But I say, I find Brother John's coldness to be peculiarly painful. I expected a warmer welcome here, especially considering this is the first time I have come here.
Uncle Jack, if you don't shake hands with Ernest, I will never forgive you.
Forgive me?
Never, never, never.
Well, it shall be the last time I ever do so. It's joyous enough to see so perfect a reconciliation. I think we might leave the two brothers together.
Cecily, you will come with us.
Yes, Miss Prism, my little task of reconciliation is over.
You have done a beautiful action today, dear child.
Let us not be premature in our judgments.
I feel very happy.
You young scoundrel, Auntie, you must get out of here as soon as possible. I do not allow any bundling to be done here.
I put Mr. Ernest's things in the room next to you, sir. I suppose that is all right.
What?
Luggage, sir. I've unpacked it and put it in the room next to your own.
His luggage?
Yes, sir. Three portmanteaus, a dressing case, two hat boxes, and a large luncheon basket.
I'm afraid I can't stay for more than a week, Mr. May I be ordered a dark cart at once? Mr. Ernest has been called suddenly back to town.
Yes, sir.
What a fearful liar you are, Jack. I haven't been called back to town at all. Yes, you have. I haven't heard anyone call me. Your duty as a gentleman calls you back.
My duty as a gentleman has never interfered with my pleasures in the smallest degree.
But I can quite understand that.
Well, Cecily is a darling.
You're not to talk of Miss Cartoon like that. I don't like it.
Well, I don't like your clothes. Perfectly ridiculous in them.
Why on earth don't you go and change them? It's perfectly childish to be in a deep mourning for a man who is actually staying at your house for a whole week. I can't grotesque. You're certainly not staying at my house a whole week as a guest or anything else. You must leave now. By the 4:05 train.
Oh, well, I certainly won't leave you as long as you're in mourning.
Most unfriendly. If I were in mourning, you'd stay with me, I suppose. I should think it very unkind if you didn't. Well, will you go if I change my clothes?
Yes, if you're not too long about it. I've never seen anyone take so long to dress with such little results.
It is better than always being overdressed as you are.
If I'm occasionally a bit overdressed, I make up for it by being always immensely overeducated.
Your vanity is ridiculous. Your conduct, an outrage, and your presence in my garden is utterly absurd! However, you've got a train to catch, and I hope you have a very pleasant journey back to town. This Bunbury, as you call it, has not been a great success for you.
I think it's been a great success. I'm in love with Cecily, and that is everything. But I must see them before I go, and make arrangements for another Bunbury.
There she is.
Oh! I merely came back to water the roses! I'm flirting them with Uncle Jack.
He's going to send a dog cart for me.
Oh, is he going to take you for a nice drive?
He's going to send me away.
Then have we got to part?
I'm afraid so. It is a painful part.
It is always painful to part from people who one has known for a very brief space of time. The absence of old friends one can endure with equanimity, but even a momentary separation from anyone to whom one has just been introduced is almost unbearable.
Thank you. The dog cart is at the door, sir.
It can wait, Merriman, for 5 minutes.
Yes, miss. I hope I shall not offend you, Cecily, if I state quite frankly and openly that you seem to me to be in every way the visible personification of absolute perfection.
I think your frankness does you great credit, Ernest. If you will allow me, I will copy your remarks into my diary.
Do you really keep a diary? I have anything to look at, may I?
Oh, no. You see, it is simply a very young girl's record of her own thoughts and impressions, and consequently meant for publication. After here's a volume form, I hope you'll order a copy. But pray, Ernest, don't stalk. I delight in taking down from dictation. I have reached absolute perfection. You may go on now. I am quite ready for more. Don't cough, Ernest. When one is dictating, one should speak fluently and not cough. Besides, I don't know how to spell cough.
Cecily, ever since I first looked upon your wonderful and incomparable beauty, I have dared to love you wildly, passionately, devotedly, helplessly.
I don't think you should say you love me wildly, passionately, devotedly, hopelessly. Hopelessly doesn't seem to make much sense, does it?
Oh, Cecily!
The dog cart is waiting, sir.
Tell it to come around next week, at the same hour.
Yes, sir.
Uncle Jack would be very much annoyed if he knew you were staying on till next week, same hour.
I don't care about Jack. I don't care about anyone in the whole world but you. I love you, Cecily. You will marry me, won't you?
You silly boy! Of course! Why, we've been engaged for the last 3 months.
For the last 3 months?
Yes. It will be exactly 3 months on Thursday.
But how did we become engaged?
Well, ever since Uncle Jack first confessed that he had a younger brother who was very wicked and bad, you, of course, were the chief topic of conversation between myself and this prism. And, of course, a man who is much talked about is always very attractive. One feels there must be something in him after all. I dare say it was foolish of me, but I fell in love with you, Ernest.
Darling! And when was the engagement actually settled?
On the 14th of February last. Worn out by your entire ignorance of my existence, I determined to end the matter one way or another. And after a long struggle with myself, I accepted you. Under this dear old tree here. The next day I went out and bought this little ring in your name. And this is the little bangle with the true love's knot I promised you always to wear.
Did I give you this? Oh, it's very pretty, isn't it?
You have wonderfully good taste, Ernest. The excuse I've always given you for leading such a bad life. And this is the box in which I keep all your dear letters.
My letters? My sweet Cecily, I haven't written you any letters.
You need hardly remind me of that, Ernest. I remember only too well that I was forced to write all your letters for you. I wrote always 3 times a week, and sometimes oftener.
Would you let me read them, Cecily?
Oh, I couldn't possibly. They would make you far too conceited. The 3 you wrote to me after I had broken off the engagement are so beautiful, so badly spelled, that even now I can hardly read them without crying a little.
But was our engagement ever broken off?
Of course it was. On the 22nd of last March. You can see the entry if you like. Today, I broke off the engagement with Ernest. I feel it is better to do so. The weather still continues charming.
Why on earth did you break it off? What have I done?
I have done nothing at all!
Cecily, I am very much hurt indeed to hear you broke it off, particularly when the weather was so charming.
Well, it would hardly have been a really serious engagement if it hadn't been broken off at least once. But I forgave you before the week was out.
What a perfect angel you are, Cecily.
You dear romantic boy. I hope your hair curls naturally, does it?
Yes, darling, with a help from others.
I'm so glad.
You'll never break off our engagement again, Cecily.
I don't think I could now that I've actually met you. Besides, of course, there's the question of your name.
Yes, of course.
You mustn't laugh at me, darling, but it has always been a girlish dream of mine to love someone with the name of Ernest. There is something in that name that seems to inspire absolute confidence. I pity any poor married woman whose husband is not called Ernest.
But my dear child, you don't mean to say you couldn't love me if I had some other name.
But what name?
Oh, any name you'd like. Algernon, for instance.
But I don't like the name of Algernon.
Dear, sweet, loving little darling, I don't really see why I should object to the name of Algernon. It isn't at all a bad name. In fact, it's a rather aristocratic name. I'll have to chat to get into the bankruptcy court to count Algernon. Seriously, Cecily, if my name was Algie, couldn't you love me?
I might respect you. I might admire your character, but I fear that I would not be able to give you my undivided attention.
Cecily! Your acting here, I suppose, is thoroughly experienced in all the rites and ceremonies of the church.
Oh, yes. Dr. Tussable's a most learned man. He's never written a single book, so you can imagine how much he knows.
And to see him at once on the most important christening, I mean, most important business.
Oh.
I shouldn't be waiting more than half an hour.
Considering that we have been engaged since February the 14th, and I have only met you today for the first time, I think it is rather hard that you should leave me for so long a period as half an hour. Couldn't you make it 20 minutes?
I'll be back in no time.
What an impetuous boy! I like his hair so much. I must enter his proposal into my diary. A Miss Fairfax has just called on Mr. Worthing on very important business, Miss Fairfax states. Isn't Mr. Worthing in his library? He was seen headed in the direction of the rectory some time ago. Ask the lady to come out here. Mr. Worthing is sure to be back soon. And you can bring tea. Yes, miss. Miss Fairfax, I suppose one of the many good elderly women associated with Uncle Jack and some of his philanthropic work in London. I don't quite like women who are interested in philanthropic work. I think it is so forward of them. Miss Fairfax. Pray, let me introduce myself to you. My name is Cecily Cardew. Cecily Cardew! What a very sweet name. Something tells me that we are going to be great friends. I like you already more than I can say. My first impressions of people are never wrong. How nice of you to like me so much after we've known each other such a comparatively short time. Pray, sit down. I may call you Cecily, may I not? With pleasure. And you will always call me Gwendolyn, won't you?
If you wish.
Then this is all quite settled, is it not?
I hope so.
Perhaps this might be a favourable opportunity for my mentioning who I am. My father is Lord Bracknell. You have never heard of Papa, I suppose?
I don't think so.
Outside the family circle, Papa, I am glad to say, is entirely unknown. That is quite as I think it should be. The home seems to me to be the proper sphere for the man. And once a man begins to neglect his domestic duties, he becomes painfully effeminate, does he not? And I don't like that. It makes me very attractive. Cecily, Mama, whose views on education are remarkably strict, has brought me up to be extremely short-sighted. It is all part of her system. So do you mind my looking at you through my glasses?
Oh, not at all, Gwendolyn. I'm very fond of being looked at.
You are here on a short visit, I suppose.
Oh, no. I live here.
Really? Mother, no doubt, or some female relative of advanced years resides here also.
Oh no, I have no mother, nor in fact any relations.
Indeed.
My dear guardian, with the assistance of Miss Prism, has the arduous task of looking after me.
Your guardian?
Yes, I am Mr. Worthing's ward.
Oh. Strange, he never mentioned to me that he had a ward. How very secretive of him. He grows more interesting hourly. I'm not sure, however, that the news inspires me with feelings of unmixed delight. I'm very fond of you, Cecily. I've liked you ever since I met you. But I am bound to state that now that I know you are Mr. Worthing's ward, I cannot help expressing a wish that you were, well, a little bit older than you seem to be and not quite
pardon, Gwendolyn, but did you say Ernest?
Yes.
Oh, well, it is not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is my guardian. It's his brother, his elder brother.
Ernest never mentioned to me that he had a brother.
I am sorry to say they have not been on good terms for a long time.
That accounts for it, then. And now that I think of it, I have never heard any man mention his brother. The subject seems distasteful to most men. Oh, Cecily, you have lifted a load from my mind. I was growing almost anxious. It would be terrible if any cloud had come across a friendship like ours, would it not? Of course, you are quite sure that it is not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is your guardian.
Quite sure. In fact, I'm going to be his.
I beg your pardon. Girl, can I require tea?
fashionable anymore. Cake or bread and butter?
Bread and butter. Cake is rarely seen in the best houses nowadays.
And this to Miss Fairfax.
I never had a brother, and I certainly have not the smallest intention of having one in the future.
No brother at all?
None.
Had you never a brother of any kind?
Never. Not even of any kind.
I'm afraid it has become quite clear, dear Cecily, that neither of us is engaged to be married to anyone.
It is not a very pleasant position for a young girl to suddenly find herself in, is it?
Let us hear into the house. They will hardly venture to come after us there.
No. Men are so cowardly, aren't they?
This ghastly state of things is what you call bunburying, I suppose.
Yes. And a perfectly wonderful bunbury it is. The most wonderful bunbury I've ever had in my life.
Well, you've no right whatsoever to bunbury here.
That's absurd. One has a right to bunbury wherever one chooses. Every sales bunbury knows that.
Well, the only small satisfaction I have in the whole of this wretched business is that your friend Bunbury is quite exploded. You won't be able to run down to the country quite as often as you used to, dear Algy. And a very good thing it is, too.
Your brother is a little off-colour, isn't he, dear Jack? You'll be able to disappear to London quite so frequently as your wicked custom was. Not a bad thing either.
And as for your conduct towards Miss Cardew, I think that your taking in of a sweet, simple, innocent girl like that is utterly inexcusable. To say nothing of the fact that she is my ward.
I can see no possible defence at all for your deceiving a brilliant, clever, thoroughly experienced young lady like Miss Fairfax.
Say nothing of the fact that she is my cousin. To be engaged to Gwendolyn, that is all.
I love her.
I simply want to be engaged to Cecily. I adore her. How you can sit there, calmly eating muffins, while we are in this horrible trouble I can't make out. You seem to me to be perfectly heartless.
Well, I can't eat muffins in an agitated manner. The butter will probably get on my cuffs.
One must eat muffins quite calmly. That is the only way to eat them.
I say, it's perfectly heartless of you to be eating it all under the circumstances.
When I am in trouble, eating is the only thing that concerns me.
Well, that is no reason at all for you to be eating them in such a green way.
I wish you were that tea cake instead. I don't like tea cake.
Oh, good heavens! I suppose a man may eat his own muffins in his own garden.
Oh, but I thought you just said it was perfectly heartless to be eating muffins.
I said it was perfectly heartless of you under the circumstances. That is quite a different matter.
Yes, but the muffins are the same.
Algy, I wish to goodness you would go. I don't want you here. Why don't you go?
Well, I haven't finished my tea yet. And there's still one muffin left.